Good morning, Grace Church!
Hey, some people might watch this in the afternoon or night.
Okay, good morning, afternoon, and evening to Grace Church!
We miss you!
Yay!
Morning, online family. And a special welcome to those who may be joining us for the first time this morning. It's really lovely to have you with us. I've got a few notices for everyone. The first one is about an initiative called Try Praying. Now, this initiative is aimed at those who perhaps don't yet have a personal relationship with Jesus. And it's a 7-day guide to encourage people to give praying a go. And there's some really wonderful stories in it where God has answered people's prayer. And we've got a banner outside the Grace Centre if you've been past there recently, and a box of booklets for people to help themselves to. Perhaps you've got some friends who you'd love to give one of these to, so please just be in touch with Dave and he'll get a couple of booklets to you. The second thing is part of our desire as a church to really embrace and celebrate our cultural diversity. We've got an evening coming up together next Tuesday, and we're going to encourage those who've had perhaps unfortunate experiences of racism to just share those with us, either recent experiences or some things that have come from the past, and just really be able to listen to one another and understand one another's backgrounds further. I think it's going to be a really valuable time together. And so I'd encourage you to make next Tuesday a priority. And Tuzzle and Temi will be leading that time. So that's wonderful. Now we've got a little update from Dave on reopening the Grace Centre. So high five, Dave. Over to you.
Good morning, Grace Church. It's great to be with you again. I just want to fill you in a little bit about our current situation in regards to the Grace Centre and opening up the building again for public gatherings. I know you're all itching to get back there. I know you're all sort of chomping at the bit, and we're missing being together. I believe it, all of us are. We're all missing coming together to worship, coming together just to be with one another, coming together to hear God's word brought to us. And so our desire is to be in that place where we are able to do all of those things and hear God's word sort of just impacting us as his people. So the government announced last week that churches can open from Saturday the 4th of July going forwards. And that of course is great news, but as Grace Church we won't be opening the building from this Sunday or from today if you're watching this as part of the Sunday online. Things are not just going to return back to normal as they were before March. Expect for a little while yet things to be different, and expect, I guess, don't expect everything just to be as it was before. And I want to just share with you some of the things that we can be doing, even though we're not opening publicly, and that we will be doing as a church to try and work towards opening publicly. So the government have released a comprehensive guide for places of worship, and we've been looking through that this week, trying to look at what does that mean for us, how does those things work out, and we came to the conclusion that actually it doesn't mean for us a lot changes right now. So predominantly we're going to keep with what we're doing with the online church, and we're going to keep going the way we are. And going forwards, we want to keep an online presence because we understand that not everybody will be able to meet at the Grace Centre. There'll be certain people in certain people groups that are unable to meet because of health conditions or other things. So we want to continue to bring something online. And what we do want to do is try and start to introduce live elements to that, to our Sunday meetings as well. And at some point in the future, that's our sort of goal, is to try and start doing that. And then to hopefully invite a few people down to the Grace Centre as well to come and be part of that. But that's looking a little bit further forward. It's going to take us a little while to learn how to do all these things, We want to make sure that we're doing things really well, serving you really well, and not just throwing things together. We want it to be a good experience for people watching on the screen, and we want it to be a good experience for people that are with us there in person as well. So, as I said, the first stage that we're thinking of doing this is we're going to start recording elements of our Sunday mornings down at the Grace Centre. So you'll see, actually, if you're watching on Sunday, you'll see this Sunday Ian has been speaking from the Grace Centre, where that's been recorded. So there may be other elements that we can do from the Grace Centre in future weeks as well. One of the things that we love to do together as a church is worship God. And at the moment, we're unable to do that together in the sense of us all coming together in one place and worshipping God with singing and playing of instruments and just shouting out our prayers and our praises. And we're going to continue using our worship team to hopefully bless you on Sunday mornings. Because at the moment, communal worship isn't allowed, and the coming together of people, you could potentially have one singer, but you have to have a screen in front of them, and we just don't think it's helpful for us for the way that we celebrate doing church together. So, but if the point comes when we start to introduce people to Sunday morning meetings, as in watching at the Grace Centre, then those worship times will have to take a more reflective feel, we think, because we're unable to sing together, we're unable to lift our voices together. All these things sort of make up these elements that sort of would be a restrictive church, which is not what we want to do at all. So on a Sunday morning, we're planning to slowly introduce. Initially, it'd just be the people that are there, needed there, to make Sunday morning happen, so all the technical side of things, maybe the person speaking. So we want to get our heads around that whole thing, the way that might work, and slowly introduce other things to that then. As I said before, we really want people's experience to be a good one, whether it's on the screen or whether it's someone there in person. So we're just going to take things slowly. Please bear with us. Please be with us in prayer and just in standing with us. And we're all learning, we're all sort of trying to get our heads around how this is going to work. And then with the hope and the intention that actually a bit further down the line, maybe from August, we can start introducing maybe a life group each Sunday to come and be part of those Sunday mornings. When we do that, whenever we bring people to the Grace Centre, we've got to make sure that we are still keeping distances, that we are adhering and abiding by all the regulations and the rules that have been put in place. So it means things like there won't be any refreshments. The government have very much put these guidelines in place, and it means there shouldn't be any sort of socially coming together. So you'd be there for the service and then you'd be asked to leave. Again, I think it just makes how we do church very difficult and very hard, which is again another reason why we're predominantly keeping things online. As part of this whole process, health and safety is really important to us. So from next week, we're bringing Beth back off furlough and Natasha back off furlough. So I've asked her to just spend a lot of time, her work time, looking at us as a church, our policies, our procedures. Are we doing everything that we should be doing? Are we being responsible employers? Are we being responsible leaders? Initially, we need to do a COVID-19 risk assessment for the building and for all the activities that we do. So all this takes time, and we don't, as I said before, we don't want to rush into things. We want to do things well and properly. It's also not just the coming together side of things, but we need to think about the cleaning of the building, and hence why we're bringing Natasha off furlough as well, so she can carry on with the great job that she does around the building. So far I've sort of said a lot of things that we can't do, but I want to really encourage you to think about what you can do, what we can do as God's church. As of Saturday the 4th of July, we're able to invite other people into our homes, so bringing two families together. So maybe you can invite another family over to watch church together. Maybe you could invite them to watch church and stay for lunch. Or maybe you could invite a couple more people over if you're planning on staying in New Garden, because you can still have up to six people from multiple households in your garden. So there's just ways in which you can be, we can be still building together, still building friendships, still standing with one another. And just, we need to start making the situation work for us, rather than just sitting back and waiting for things to happen. Let's take the first step, let's take the steps forwards, and let's push towards new things for what God's got for us. So to round things off, there's a few elements that you might be wondering about. So prayer meetings, so one of the recommendations for places of worship is to avoid singing, or for spoken responses not to be in a raised voice. So for that reason, we're going to keep doing our prayer meetings online and for the immediate future, really. Life groups, again, we're going to encourage people to continue meeting online as you have been over the past few months, or to meet in smaller groups. So again, up to groups of six in people's gardens. And if meeting up in person, I'm afraid we're going to have to say that there's no sung worship, so you won't be able to sing together, again, because that's one of the stipulations that are in place as a place of worship. And finally, Sunday mornings. So again, primarily stay in the way that they are at the moment. And we hope to, by August, start inviting small groups along to the Grace Centre to be part of the Sunday mornings. Initially just watching on the screens together. And again, we won't be able to sing together currently as the regulations stand. So the worship would need to take more of a reflective feel. And we need to make sure that we're adhering to social distances at all times. We also hope to, one of the things we do want to do about Sunday mornings is invite some people to be part of, maybe part of the recording of the sermons or the preachers or other elements. So please look out for that communication going forwards, as we're able to start using the building in little ways. And again, and finally, I just want to encourage each and every one of us. I don't want this season to be a season of just sitting and waiting. We've done a lot of, some of us have done a lot of just sitting and waiting for things to be brought to us, things and guidances of what we can do next. And I want us to take the opportunities that are in front of us now, make the most of them. And it'd be easy for us to mark time. So mark time is, if you're not familiar with what mark time is, as a soldier is marching, if he gets the command to mark time, he starts marching on the spot and doesn't really go anywhere. And let's not be like people that are marking time, but let's be bold in moving forwards. Let's be bold in inviting others. Let's try and excel in our hospitality of people. Restrictions limit us from being hospitable at the Grace Centre at the moment, but in your homes you can be hospitable. So let me really encourage you to love one another, to stand with one another, and just to encourage, keep encouraging one another throughout these times. If you've got any questions about any of this, then please feel free to ring me or email me, whatever is easiest for you. And I'll speak to you soon. Take care.
And finally, the offering. Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 to 23 say this: because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And this morning, as we come and consider our giving, we're just remembering how wonderful God has been to us. And I just encourage you this morning to reflect again on God's faithfulness and his love towards us. And as we give, it's part of our worship to God. So let's just pray as we connect with our giving. Obviously, it's coming for most of us from our bank accounts, and particularly at the current time. So let's just pray together. Lord, we thank you for your amazing goodness and faithfulness to us. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. And we're just a grateful people this morning. and we love to give to you. And we just present our offering before you, and we just ask you to bless it. And Lord God, I just pray for those, particularly at the moment, who are concerned over their finances. Lord, may they feel encouraged this morning as they remember your faithfulness, Lord God. And you don't change, so your faithfulness is extended to us this morning. And we bless you and thank you, God. And I just pray, Lord, that those who are struggling will just know blessing and increase in every area. And we thank you, God. Amen. Okay, it's been great chatting to you. If you want to give, there's opportunities to give online. But yeah, enjoy the rest of the service.
Morning, everyone. I just want to encourage you with some words from Psalm 121 this morning before we go into worship. And I'm reading from the Message version. I look up to the mountains. Does my strength come from mountains? No, my strength comes from God, who made heaven and earth and mountains. He won't let you stumble. Your guardian God won't fall asleep. Not on your life. Israel's guardian will never doze or sleep. God's your guardian, right at your side to protect you, shielding you from sunstroke, sheltering you from moonstroke. God guards you from every evil. He guards your very life. He guards you when you leave and when you return. He guards you now. He guards you always. Amen.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. With truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. You lay down your is the king who conquered the grave. Worthy is the lamb who was slain. Worthy is the king. King conquered the grave. Worthy is the lamb who was slain. Worthy is the king who conquered the grave. Worthy is the lamb who was slain. Worthy is the king who conquered the grave. Worthy is the king who conquered the grave.
Good morning, Grace Church. It's great to be with you today. And if you're a visitor today, then it's great to have you with us today as well. And as you can see, I don't know how evident it is, but we're actually from the Grace Center today. So there we go. There's something new for us. I'm certainly appreciating the fact that I'm not just in my room at home. So that's great to be coming from the Grace Center to you today. I wonder if any of you has had a wild experience at sea. I've had one or two. And one in particular that comes to mind was from when I was a teenager, and we used to go on sailing holidays, and we were out in the west of Scotland, and we'd actually booked a yacht, a proper 40-foot thing, for about a week or so, and we were there with my family and my uncle. and it was not going well. We'd hit a storm, a proper storm. What made it really particularly not good was that my dad, who was like the proper sailor amongst us, the one who was like in charge, the one who was going to be holding the tiller, making sure everything was going well, he was proper sick. I mean, sick. All right. So the image I have in my mind is of my dad basically kind of, you know, he was in the cabin. He was that bad. But then every 10 minutes or so, he had to come running for the back of the boat because he was literally vomiting that often. I mean, this was like sick, you know. So my poor uncle, who is not really so much of a sailor, he was now holding the tiller in the middle of a storm, and is like, oh, what's going on? And it was actually a bit proper scary. It really was. We didn't know kind of how this was going to go. My dad was out of it. My uncle's given it his best. And it's like, oh, I'm looking at the charts. Where can we get anchored? What can we do? We ended up finding a place, wouldn't you know it, it was actually called the Bolt Hole. And it was just opposite from my owner. And we did manage to be there for the night, drop anchored down. But it was wild. It was a little bit scary. And we're going to look today at one of the wilder moments in the Gospels, which actually did happen at sea. Now, this message has been burning in my heart for quite a while now, and I'm really eager for us to share it today. But it really speaks to our situation, because Jesus knows our number one need is for encounter with him. And there's encounter for us in this message. So let's get straight into it. It's in Matthew's gospel. I imagine for a lot of you, it's a familiar passage. Chapter 14. And I'm going to read from verse 22. Immediately, he, Jesus, made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." What a passage! It's amazing, absolutely amazing what happens here. And there's so much for us right here. And I want to start with a very really important context. This happened immediately after the feeding of the 5,000. That's the transition point in the Gospels. So if you can just imagine, it had been crowds of people, an amazing miracle, a high point, good times, everyone together, God moving, everyone excited. And what does Jesus do at that point? We just read, he sent the disciples into something new, and then it says, while he dismissed the crowds. Not what probably what we would do, is it? When the crowds are coming, we want to keep the crowds coming. Oh, the crowds are here. This is great. Let's keep this going. Jesus shuts it all down. Does that sound familiar to you? everything being shut down, the crowds dispersing. You see, Jesus is Lord of our situation. We see it right there in the Gospels. He shut the whole thing down. He is Lord of the lockdown situation. He shut it down then. He's Lord of our lockdown now. And he sends the disciples, he transitions the disciples into a new reality, a very important reality, where they're going to go into a storm and they're going to learn to overcome the storm, not through themselves, but through him. So am I saying that Jesus has sent this storm? Has he sent this virus? I want to be very clear with you. I'm not going to give you a paper-thin answer to what's as complex and more so than a cube. So I'm not going to give some sort of simple soundbite answer, but I am going to say very clearly what we see here is Jesus is Lord of the situation. And isn't that encouraging? In everything that's happening to us, he's bigger than it all. He's totally Lord of it all. And he sends the disciples, they're going into a storm. He knows they're going into a storm, and it's actually his purpose. He's going to work through that very situation, and it's going to be an overcoming situation. That's his heart. But it doesn't look like that at first, because it's several hours before Jesus comes to them. He's up, it says, on the mountain praying, and then it says, because by this time, when he comes to them, by this time, it says that the waves were against them, the wind was against them, they were struggling, they were in a mess. And, you know, this is how it can feel to us. Where's God? Why hasn't he arrived yet? Why is it taking so long for deliverance to come? And it was right there in the gospel. And this is not lack of love. This is not what we could misinterpret it as. This is not God not caring. This is Jesus who's just shown his love feeding the 5,000. He loves them. In fact, he loves them too much to come to them early, because it said it, he came to them in the third watch of the night, or the fourth watch of the night. I can't remember which one it is, but it's about 3 a.m. It's at the lowest point of the night. Because then, you see, the rescue is going to be a really true rescue. It's going to reflect the fact that we are not in control and we can't handle this situation, this storm, this virus, this whatever it is that might be our time of difficulty. We can't handle it ourselves. We need rescuing. But then here's the wonderful words. He came to them. Isn't that beautiful? Aren't these beautiful words for us today? He came to them, walking on the waves. I just want us to pause there. Because if you're somebody who doesn't yet know the Lord Jesus for yourself, this is a great picture of what he wants to do in your life, and maybe how you feel now. Or maybe this is helping you to see your life now, that without God, we are literally in a storm that we can't control, and life is against us, and it doesn't work without him. And the problem of sin is a problem that we can't control and deal with. And it's like being in a wild storm, and you're left there, and it's not going well. But the heart of God is to come to you. That's why Jesus came to those that he cared for. He came to them, and he comes to you today to bring salvation power. And I would just say to you, the best decision I ever made in my life was when I opened my heart, my life, my future, my everything to the Lord Jesus Christ. It happened when I was 18 years old, as you can tell. I'm not that anymore. I'm significantly older, but he's been with me ever since that time, and he's transformed and is transforming my life. And I just would urge you, open your heart to Jesus today, turn your life over to him, and you will know salvation when you do that. Don't miss your moment. Don't miss your moment. But you know, Jesus comes to us who already know him. He came to the disciples, those who already knew him. So I want to speak equally to those of you who know the Lord Jesus today. Now, let's just see the richness of the Gospels here. He comes to them on the waves of the storm. This is powerful. In other words, he comes to you through your trouble. Or maybe we should say more than that, through his lordship over your trouble. What does this look like? Well, I can tell you very clearly, it's not cozy. You see, we're over familiar with the passage, right? We know that Jesus walks on the water because we've read it before. Well, it's just Jesus walking on the water. Silly disciples, why are you thinking he's a ghost? Don't you know he walks in the water? No, actually, they didn't know. That's the whole point. He'd never come to them that way before. Now we've seen he can multiply bread. We've seen he can heal people, but we don't know he can walk on the water. And so when he comes to us that way, we don't recognize it. Now, we're in the middle of a situation that we're not in control of. And you know what? As Jesus comes to us in that situation, it is ever so easy for us not to recognize him, exactly as the disciples didn't, exactly the same for us. You see, they were in a nightmare of a storm, and now they've got a worse nightmare. Jesus coming, and they think he's a ghost. It's fear. Now, I have to say to you, right, this is not unloving. It might not look like it, but actually this is loving. This is what we need. You see, we can't accommodate Jesus into our own world that we're in control of. He's bigger than that. No, we must become a part of his world, where he is the center and we revolve around him. Now, I have to say to you, that is disturbing, and sometimes part of the process of that happening involves us experiencing an element of fear, where we can't see him for who he is because we can't compute it yet. We can't fit it into our way of understanding things. And for many of you, and this has been my experience as well, Jesus has been coming to you over the waves of your trouble and difficulty, but because of his lordship stirring up these waves, you're reacting in fear. Just like those disciples. You're not seeing him necessarily coming to you. It doesn't necessarily look like love in the same way that if somebody's trying to take a splinter out your hand, you know, as a little kid, that doesn't look like love, doesn't it? Ah, you're hurting me. I don't get what's going on, but this is love and I have to remove this and I have to deal with it. And it feels painful and fearful at the time. And you know, we've had questions, we've had doubts, we've had fears. My job's gone. I don't have it anymore. What do I do now? Or I'm in a job, but loads of other people aren't in a job. That doesn't seem very fair. I'm struggling with that now. Or I was expecting to go to university. That doesn't seem to be happening now. What's happened to my path of my life? What's happened to the way I think things were going to go? When is this virus going to go? Is it ever going to go? Are we going to get another one? Questions, questions, questions. What is this life all about anyway? I thought I had my fixed points of reference. I thought I had it all. I understood things. And now it's like everything's up in the air and it's all changed. Stirring up. But you know, Jesus is coming to us in that very stirring up. And maybe we're struggling to recognize him and we're reacting in fear. But you know, that fear means that we're going a bit like this. Ah! But do you see my hands are now in the air? That because of the fear, actually, it opens up our heart now. Look, Jesus speaks into that situation where they're freshly opened through their fear. And it's at that moment where he says, "It is I. Do not be afraid." And here's the encounter, you see. We need to hear this, all right? We need to enter into the security of who he is. We need that secure point, not in anything else but in Him. This is massive for us. Have a fresh awareness of Him saying to you, it is I. Even in that stirring up, even in that difficulties, even in those questions, even in that uncertainty, it is I. But you know, it's time for that encounter to go deeper, because that's not where Jesus finishes. It's time for us to join Him. What does Peter say? Lord, if it's you. Now that question, I believe, was inspired by Jesus. What does he say? Command me to come to you on the waves. Come on, where's that come from? You're in the middle of the storm. Lord, if it's you, command me to come on the water to you. What crazy thinking is that? I mean, you know, I think, I'm convinced that was inspired by the presence of Jesus. And do you know, his presence inspires our breakthrough. As his presence comes, we have possibilities for breakthrough that open up for us, where without his presence, we're just struggling. But in his presence, suddenly, possibility of breakthrough. And right now, you see, as his presence comes to you through his word, now the possibility of breakthrough is freshly with you, for you to step like Peter into a new reality right now. And so that was inspired, I believe, by Jesus. And it allows us, you see, if it's you, I find this beautiful. You see, God's happy for us to come with an if. At the start of this, there's a process of revelation here. If it's you, you command me to come. Because you see, Peter's looking for a further confirmation. If it's you, and then if you speak to me, I'll know it is you. And so it's okay to come with an if. Lord, if it's you, would you lead me further? Would you show me something more? Would you open more of yourself to me? And what does Jesus say? I'm going to give you what you ask for. And he gives him that one powerful, confirming word, come. And into the power of that word, Peter steps out. And can I just say to you, the Lord is so gracious to lead you into breakthrough, not to expect you to take some massive leap, but to lead you through like a parent leading a child, leading you, starting with if, giving you more confirmation, giving you something solid to step onto. It's wonderful. Now, let's just pause for a moment and enjoy the moment, okay? Like with Peter, there he is. He stepped out onto the waves. He stepped out onto Jesus' reality, and he's actually on the waves now. We can have a little tap dance on the waves. Do you know, even in the middle of the storm, this would have been maybe even almost a bit of fun, I don't know. Maybe it's so wild, maybe it might be, it's going to be scary, isn't it? It's standing there in the waves, pretty scary, pretty wild, maybe a bit of fun. Anyway, this is the Christian life. Walking with Jesus is a bit scary sometimes. It can be pretty wild. Maybe it's actually a bit fun. It's certainly supernatural. And we're with him. But you know what? So is the next situation. All too familiar to us, I'm sure. But when Peter saw the wind, he was afraid and beginning to sink. I wonder, can anyone relate to that? We all can, can't we? When he saw the wind, he was afraid and beginning to sink. You see, the wind says, who do you think you are, walking on the water? What? Or who do you think you are, speaking for Jesus when you live that way and you're not the best Christian? Or who do you think you are, think you're going to pray for somebody to be healed? Who do you think you are? Or who do you think you are, resisting temptation? You're just going to give in, aren't you? Or who do you think you are, trusting Jesus when everything around you seems to say that it's not going to work out? That's what the wind keeps saying to us. But what does Jesus say? He says, come. Come to me. Come where I am. Walk with me on the water. Share my victory. You were born for this, says Jesus to you. You're mine. I will never fail you. You see, our sinking is to do with our thinking. And our thinking is to be anchored into his being. Who he is, what he's done, what he's doing now. Let's unpack this further. Go back to the story. He cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand, took hold of him, saying to him, again, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" It's so important, this. It's so important. We might think, it's a little harsh, isn't it? I mean, he's the only guy walking on the beach. Shouldn't he be saying, "Don't worry, everyone gets a bit frightened looking at the waves, you know, the wind. You know, you were bound to sink, weren't you, really? You know, nobody else got out of the boat. Well done, Peter." He doesn't say that. He says, "Why did you doubt?" He's not being harsh on us. He's not being harsh on us. Let's just remember, he's actually opening a window into abiding in Jesus in the middle of tough times. Why did you doubt? Because consider, who shut down the thousands? Who dismissed the crowds? Who was it who sent them into the storm and said, "You're going to go to the other side"? Who was it who waited until the middle of the night when it was the worst time to make the rescue true and powerful? Okay? Who was it who invited Peter to make that call? Who was it who allowed himself to be seen as a ghost first of all, if you like, knowing that this was going to be difficult for the disciples to cope with, and then said, "It's I, don't be afraid"? And invited Peter to say, "Lord, command me to come," and gives the powerful word, "Come," into which Peter can step. He's much more awesome than the storm. And when we see that, we can anchor in on him in the midst of tough times. And finally, I always want to say this, that we realize, how is he able to rescue us? He comes walking to you on the water of your trouble. Yes, he's on the waves. Yes, he's Lord of the storm, but his feet are wet with the water of your trouble. His clothes are soaked with the spray of your difficulty. He's walked into the middle of your trouble, difficulty, sin, weakness, failure, whatever it is. He's got wet and soaked with it. He's Lord over it, but he's coming across it, through it, to you. That is the cross, where Jesus has become soaked with our sin, wet with our trouble, walking into the midst of everything that has messed us up to bring deliverance to us. And he invites us to join him in that reality, to get our feet wet with Jesus and for Jesus. So just to summarize, he's Lord of the storm, Lord of the lockdown, the whole situation. We've been sent into the storm, not as a punishment, but to be overcomers of the storm through him. This happens through encounter with him, which can be scary at first. But we need to lock into him and who he is. He calls us into partnership, a partnership of faith, walking with him on the waves. We keep our eyes on him by recognizing his awesome lordship over the whole of who we are and the whole of the situation we're in. He's entered into our deliverance by entering into our storm through his cross and resurrection. That is the gospel. That is the gospel. That's the good news that transforms our lives. And it comes with blessings from God. I want to mention to you some things I believe God wants to touch today. If you have an eating problem, whether it's an eating disorder or a food intolerance situation, I believe God wants to touch that. I believe God wants to banish headaches today. I know we've prayed about this before, but headaches. If there's a situation in your toes, maybe a swelling or a skin issue with your toes, what came to mind as well was a car crash or a collision where there's been a back or spine problem. God wants to touch that. And I believe today there's grace for our extended family situations. For those that we love, we've been cut off from them in this situation, and maybe we're in fear about them, and we're in difficulty. Maybe they're in difficulty because of this. I want to say there's grace for that, to help us in that situation. And I just want us to, I want to end by just singing to you. Just quickly. And we'll just finish with this. This is just a little song that came around the time I knew I was speaking on this, just about us being invited onto the waves. It's riding on the waves of the wind. It's walking on the waves of the storm. He's the Lord Almighty, King of glory, Lord over the flood. In our time of trial, a day of trouble, you've not abandoned us to the waves. You're walking on the water, strong deliverer, our Lord Emmanuel. Lord, if it's you, would you call us to come where you are, and we will be with you, walking on the way. Lord, if it's you, would you call us to come where you are, and we will be with you, walking on the waves. Yes, we will be with you, walking on the waves. Let's sing together. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Lord, we just thank you for this encounter that you offer to us right now. We welcome the power of your Spirit into our lives and the deliverance, victory, and power that you bring into our lives to enable us to abide in you in the worst of times. Thank you, Jesus, for being with us today. Amen. Amen. If you want to make sure you join us on Zoom afterwards, after this is finished, that'd be great, and get some prayer.
Thank you so much, Ian. That was really encouraging. It's great to think about Jesus being on the waves, whatever your storm is. Wherever your storm is, that's where Jesus is at. And there's a few things that Ian mentioned during his talk there. Things that he believes God has given him, as as Christians would call words of knowledge, things that we might not know about, but we feel that God has given us to help people to realise the love of God for them. and their personal love of God for themselves. So the few things that he mentioned were someone with an eating problem, whether that be a disorder or an intolerance. He felt that headaches were going to leave, and for toes, someone with toes, something to do with swelling or something with the skin, a car crash that maybe caused problems in your back or your spine. And also the last thing was for extended family situations where people have been cut off. So if any of those things apply to you right now, we want to pray for you. I want to pray for you right now in the name of Jesus for those things to go. So if you're with somebody that has one of those problems or more than one of those problems, I'd love you just to put your hand on their shoulder. If you're not with anybody, if you're by yourself watching at home, then I'd love to just for you just to put your hand on the part of your body that is hurting, whatever that is. And we're just going to pray for these things to go in Jesus' name. And you're more than welcome to come and join us on Zoom, and we can pray with you personally then, straight after the meeting. Or please, again, if you see an improvement, we'd love to hear about that. Please let us know. So as I said, just put your hand on that place in your body that is hurting. It doesn't have to be those things that Ian mentioned. If you're in pain for anything else, we believe in a God that can heal us, a God that wants to touch us and let us know of his love for us. So just put your hand on that place of your body. So Father God, we ask, Lord Jesus, for your kingdom to come and your will be done in these bodies where people have their hands, Lord Jesus. We pray for headaches to go now in the name of Jesus. And we pray for eating problems, Lord Jesus. We thank you for the eating problems that we've seen go in our church so far, Lord Jesus. And we pray for more, Lord God. We want to see eating disorders leave in the name of Jesus. We want to pray for food intolerances, Lord. Would they stop being, would people stop being intolerant to certain foods, Lord God? I pray for a feast in people's lives where they've experienced intolerances. We pray for toes, Lord, where there's swelling or skin issues. We pray for skin to be renewed and refreshed. We pray for swelling to reduce and toes to return to normal. And we pray for back and spine problems, Lord Jesus. Would you heal people with your love, Lord God? Would you heal people with your touch? We pray for any things where backs are misaligned or things are just hurting, Lord God. We pray for the peace of God and the love of God to flow through spines, to flow through bones, to flow through discs in the name of Jesus. And lastly, we just pray for family situations, Lord, where people have felt cut off from family members or stuff has gone on, Lord Jesus. We just pray for reconciliation. We pray for healing in the name of Jesus. Amen. So it'd be great to hear, guys, if you've prayed for something this morning and you experience a measure of healing, please let us know. If you've joined us this morning and you just want to know a bit more about Jesus or a bit more about Grace Church, then please click on the links at the top if you're watching on Church Online. And also there's going to be a little button that pops up in the chat as well. You can click on that button and that will enable you to connect with us a little bit more. And of course we're on Facebook, so have a look at us on Facebook. You can send us a message via that as well. We'd love to tell you about Grace Church. We'd love to welcome you. We'd love to just build a friendship with you. So I hope you've had a wonderful morning and we look forward to seeing you again soon. Take care.